Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Avin Dirki, a board member of SAF. I would like to welcome you all to our event. To support our people and our kids and support our nation here to set our nation in the United States too from the terrorists. It's a message from our kids' heart to American heart. Please tell your government, tell United States government and senators and president, stop the terrorists and support the terrorists in Syria. Enough. Our kids, they have dream and we want their dream to come true. We want the smile on their face again. We want to take their tears from their eyes and the sadness from their heart. Please help us. Please put pressure on the government and the Congress and senators and the White House by calls, by sign our petition, by call the White House. Please, we need your support. Each call save Syrian kids' life and bring the happiness in our country and defend the United States, our nation, from the terrorists. Excuse me, I want to speak in Arabic, so I welcome our ambassador, our man who defend our country. We don't just love him, we respect him and love him from our heart. And each Syrian pray to Mr. Jaafari, God bless him, because he supported us and he fought to bring peace to our country. مساء الخير دكتور جعفري. اهلا وسهلا قليله نصر سوريا بقلوبنا منحبك ونتمنى دائما انه نكون عندنا الوقت لنقدر نرد لك الدين اللي على كتافنا وبقلوبنا لك انك حميت بلدنا دافعت عنا بكل دقيقه بقلب الامم المتحده. تفضل.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Avin, and thanks for this distinguished audience for coming at this very hot moment of the afternoon to show some solidarity with Syria and the Syrian people. We are grateful to all of you, the anti-war movement, namely speaking, the SAF, Syrian American Forum, and all these noble and lofty American people who decided to share with us today in the morning briefing at the UN, as well as right now at the church center here, who decided to come and share with us these important moments of solidarity with Syria and the Syrian people. We are grateful to all of you, and I'm specifically grateful to this distinguished panelist from the United States of America who went to Syria willingly to witness the experience, the new experience actually, the new electoral experience that Syria witnessed recently on June the 3rd for the presidential elections. These ladies and gentlemen came back with their own testimonies on the process of the organization of these presidential elections. They witnessed, they presented their witnesses and their testimonies this morning at the United Nations Center for Information, and now they are again are willing to share the same kind of experience with this noble and lofty audience. Syria is a victim of accumulation of some factors, some elements. Syria is a victim of terrorism, of course, but Syria is also a victim of miscalculation by heavyweight statesmen in USA and elsewhere. Syria is a victim of misleading information and misreading of the geopolitical landscape prevailing in our area. This combination of too many elements brought up a catastrophe, not only for the Syrian people, but also for the interest of the American people, for the interest of United States of America. It's somehow awkward to see that while we are fighting terrorism in Syria, some people in the United States, but also in the Gulf states, in Turkey and elsewhere, describe these same terrorists as revolutionaries, as jihadists, as militants, as insurgents, or in the best cases, they call them Sunni rebels. To play the card of, to play the sectarian and confessional cards into this crisis. Fighting terrorism in Syria means fighting terrorism in USA, in Europe, in Russia, in China, and elsewhere. Terrorists have no religion, have no nationality, have no race, have no values whatsoever, according to the United Nations General Assembly strategy to combat terrorism, for combating terrorism. This is a common denominator agreed upon by all member states of the United Nations. But still, the way people look at who is terrorist and who is not creates this big discrepancy between the theory and the practice. So I think that our main task should be to create some kind of awareness among the public opinion on the real identity of terrorism. I feel disturbed, personally speaking, when I read the New York Times headlines every morning and I see that ISIS, Daesh is called militants or fighters. In the best cases, they call them cross-border fighters or foreign fighters. So you see how many terms did I use so far? None of them describes Daesh or ISIS as terrorists. They turn around so that they avoid describing these terrorists the way they deserve it. That means somehow, deep inside themselves, they are backing these terrorists. Those who do not acknowledge these terrorists as terrorists, that means they are backing them, directly or indirectly. So this is why participating at rescuing the Syrian people from these barbarian waves of terrorists is in the interest of the United States of America and of the American people themselves. They started in Syria, they moved into Iraq, now they are creating branches elsewhere. They want to create a so-called Islamic caliphate. They don't know what they want because they are being manipulated by foreign intelligence services in order to create what they call, what one day Condoleezza Rice said, describe it as creative chaos. The chaos should be creative. Otherwise, it wouldn't be chaos. So what we are suffering from nowadays in Syria and Iraq and elsewhere is exactly the creative chaos that one day Condoleezza Rice talked about it after the invasion of Iraq. I would like to conclude by saying that we shouldn't fall in this trap of focusing on ISIS only, Daesh. ISIS is a small detail in the geopolitical landscape of what's going on in the area. ISIS is misused by foreign intelligence services to rampage and expand this chaos I was referring to all over the area. Why? It's very simple. In their mind, in the mind of the philosophers of this creative chaos, by triggering a sectarian war in the area between Muslims and Muslims, they call it Shiite and Sunni. It's like Orthodox and Catholics 500 years ago in Europe. By triggering this kind of sectarian war in the area, the Israeli policies in Palestine would have enough time to absorb the Palestinian question, to kill the dream of having a Palestinian state, to deviate the attention of the international public opinion towards another front, another war that will never end. You know, religious wars start, but they never end. And this is what they are seeking, to deviate the attention from the Israeli settlement policies, the Israeli illegal practices against the Palestinians, but also against the Syrians in the Golan, so that the Israelis will have enough time to implement their strategic plan of killing the Palestinian state dream and bringing further settlers to settle on the occupied territories. This is the big headline. This is a big scenario. And this is why I have just said that Daesh, ISIS, is a small detail in the geopolitical landscape. We shouldn't focus on them. We should focus on those who are backing ISIS, those who are backing Daesh, those who are sponsoring them, collecting them from the four corners of the planet, sponsoring them, training them in Jordan, in Turkey, the Saudi money, the Qatari money, the Kuwaiti, the Emiratis. These people should be questioned and should be held accountable. ISIS is just a bunch of criminals. We know that. You know that. Everybody knows that. But we should stop those who are backing them, those who are using them, those who are encouraging them to slaughter innocent people, whether in Syria or in Iraq. I'm very thrilled once again to sit with these distinguished panelists to share with you their own experience after their return from Syria, after their adventure in Syria, where they participated at overseeing and observing the presidential elections in Syria. So without further delay, I thank you very much, both the anti-war movement, SAF, and everybody else who worked very hard to organize this important gathering this evening. So I thank you very much, and I will give you the floor. Thank you.
Let me first start by really thanking Ambassador Dr. Bashar Jaafari for really an explanation of what is at stake in Syria today. I'm Sara Flounders from the International Action Center. I had the honor to travel to Syria last September at a time of great risk, and I had visited Syria in the past, Palestinian conferences. Welcome, Ramsey. And tonight we're here to hear about what is a great accomplishment by a people under relentless attack, more than 3 years. And this election was a historic accomplishment. The Syrian government has been a target of regime change, demonized by the Western media, a third of the population displaced, entire cities looted, and for 3 years, the media has predicted, and U.S. officials, that the government would collapse any day now, any day, any day, any week, any month. But Syria held on and reorganized and protected and defended those who were homeless, those who were displaced, managed to beat back the insurgency, who were using terror tactics with top funding from Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Kuwait, all with U.S. and NATO coordination. Really, tens of thousands, a mercenary army from 68 countries, if you can imagine. It attracted mercenaries, fanatics, and pirates of the planet to Syria. And this election, imagine defending 9,000, more than 9,000 polling places on election day. Isn't that an accomplishment? A quite incredible accomplishment. Now, U.S. wars are organized to bring chaos, to sow dissension, ethnic and religious divisions. It's the old, old policy of divide and conquer. And it's systematic. It's not an accident. It's the way the wars are fought. And it creates a horror that lasts a generation and more. We can see the heritage of it in Iraq today. And as the ambassador so well explained, ISIS, the Islamic State of Syria and Iraq, a fanatical, subsidized group, funded by the Saudis, yes, but organized and coordinated by U.S. and NATO forces. The Syrians know what they're fighting to prevent, and they know what the future holds if they fail. Millions of Syrians choose unity and sovereignty, and tonight's program is organized with our good friends in the Syrian American Forum. It's so important that here in the U.S. today, there is such a strong Syrian American voice defending and explaining Syria to people in the U.S. who see that every war brings destruction to U.S. cities. As Dr. Martin Luther King said in an earlier time, that the bombs that fall in Vietnam fall in the cities of the U.S., and that's even more so true today. It takes great courage, I'm sure, for Syrian Americans to speak out and to hold firm. And I want to especially thank Avin Dirki, a poet and an artist, who helped in this program and in others. Tonight's program is also co-sponsored by the Syrian Solidarity Movement that has helped nationally in building solidarity with Syria in forums and in meetings. And these five delegates will do so much to explain in just a few minutes each their explanations, what they saw, each of them a different vignette, and each of them were actually in different polling areas, different cities across Syria. And their contribution at the press conference organized today at the UN with the UN Correspondents Association, it just gave a real description. So I think everyone here will understand more what's happening in Syria today listening to them. Our first speaker is Scott Williams. He's a national coordinator of an anti-imperialist youth organization here in the U.S. called FIST, Fight Imperialism, Stand Together. He's also an organizer with the International Action Center, and he's mobilized demonstrations against U.S. wars in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Libya, and Syria, and for several years was a union organizer of low-wage workers. He was also active with the Occupy Wall Street movement. So Scott Williams to lead off.
Wow, well, first of all, it is my honor to speak first out of our delegation, to report back on our tremendous trip to really see what democracy in action looks like. Again, my name is Scott Williams with the International Action Center, and I've been active since 2007, organizing against the wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, Libya, Syria, and now the conflicts going on in Ukraine and Venezuela, and again in Iraq. You know, all of us are going to share our stories, but I wanted to start with a little bit of a political analysis and then go into my trip. And I wanted to start here, right in the U.S. So, you know, as election observers, you know, we did this because we believe in real democracy. The ultimate aim of democratic elections are to serve as a test of the people's desires, of the hopes and dreams of millions of people in any country. Yet, as we know, every election has its shortcomings, and some more than others. And that's why I wanted to start here in the U.S. So the most obvious example of flawed elections that I could think of comes from the United States. We choose from our politicians who are millionaires, who spend all day fighting each other over who can give more tax breaks, more budget cuts, start more wars, and give more concessions to big businesses. Decisions to spend over 50% of the budget on the Pentagon are made in country clubs, in executive suites, and by friendly handshakes of, you know, people who went to college together in elite Ivy League schools. Here we have voter participation, which is limited by the difficult voter registration requirements. And also, voting is limited by income and by, frankly, by the lack of faith in the political process. And that's why we've seen in almost every election that over a majority of people do not vote. And as they say, not voting is a vote, and it's a vote against the system. So in 2008, we remember it was a historic election of President Barack Obama here in the United States. This was the biggest turnout in quite a while, with 57% of voters voting in the presidential election. Yet still, in a country of 300 million people, and only a portion of which are adults, 51 million people in the United States were not even registered to vote. They couldn't even go to the polls. That's over a quarter of the adult population. And then the number of people who were barred where they went to go vote, and then their voting was thrown out in 2008, was more than the margin of, you know, the previous two presidential elections, to show you how much there are just consistent, you know, problems with what they call the so-called democracy here. You know, still that year, 58 countries across the world had a greater turnout, including Iran, Russia, Bolivia, Venezuela, countries all over the world. The U.S. ranked in the bottom half. If you compare the Syrian election this year, just 2 weeks ago, it would rank as the 20th highest vote in the entire world as far as voter turnout. And that's given the conditions of millions of refugees, of millions of people displaced from their homes, and of the line and of the U.S. and NATO countries limiting the vote of Syrian refugees in the United States and throughout Europe. and in the Gulf states as well. So given the conditions, I think that it shows you what real democracy looks like. The West has a bad habit of holding up Europe and North America as bastions of democracy. Commentators from Brussels to Washington can use convenient demands all over the world for free and fair elections. And we see this almost every week. They're trying to appeal to people's basic idea of democracy and self-rule. But when the U.S. touts democracy, it conveniently is reflecting its own bias, or ignoring its own bias, and looking for its own local rule of a small group of leaders that will compromise with the IMF, that will compromise with NATO, and that will compromise with the demands of the U.S. military and corporations. And that is the problem that the U.S. has with Dr. Bashar al-Assad, and that is the problem that the U.S. has with people all over the world. And, it's tremendous. Visiting Syria, you could see that the Syrian people have given up so much, and not just in the most recent 3 years of war, but over the decades. We realize that the role of the IMF in Syria over the past decades has caused many giftbacks, where Syria's had to pay back millions in foreign debt and with extorted interest rates. And then Syrians had to raise the prices on subsidized food and gasoline and social programs that people need. And we realize there's serious givebacks that have been happening for at least the last decade. What makes this even worse, though, is that the right-wing insurgents, whatever they call the so-called rebels, which I'll never use that word, they've robbed over 1,000 factories and equipment in just the city of Aleppo alone. And this has cost over $200 billion in one city, $200 billion Syrian pounds of damage. Worse yet, they're stealing Syrian oil, estimates of over $600 million a year of revenue that goes for the Syrian people. And they destroyed over 600 medical facilities across the country. We learn the gruesome stories of people and what this means to them, and they describe this as living in a horror movie, as you can imagine. But with crisis, there comes a fight back. And in Syria, for the days before and after the election that we were there, millions of Syrians came out to support their president. Some of them have serious challenges and needs from the government, but just like any internal conflict that a group faces, they unite when they're fighting a common enemy. And that is the difference between the crisis in Syria and the things that we see across so-called sectarian violence and the chaos that's been created by U.S. imperialism. The people of Syria are united, and the people of Syria will never lose to the U.S. And that was the feeling that I got. I toured Sueda on election day in southern Syria, and I was with a group of Venezuelans, Bolivians, Brazilians, and along with Jane. I hope she'll share her stories as well. And in Sueda, there were spontaneous gatherings everywhere in the city. We must have visited 15 polling places, and every single place you go, there are people left and right who, it looks like the town is having the biggest celebration it's ever had. And that's because the people are out in support of their government. And that unity is what can defeat the U.S. attacks. And as someone in the United States who cares about democracy, who cares about freedom, and who cares about a government which provides for the people's needs, to me, it was really motivating to come back to the U.S. and bring this story and take this. And that's why I'm excited to say that we are organizing across the United States a tour in cities. Next week we're going to be in Philadelphia. I think tomorrow Joe is going to be in Chicago. We're going to be all over the country spreading, showing our pictures, telling our stories, and coming together with people from the Syrian American Forum, with all of our friends and allies across the political movement, to come and tell the story of why the Syrian people are setting the standard, and the Syrian people are really leading the way, and we owe it so much to them, and we need to support them. And lastly, I just want to say, our demand, it's clear, we've been using the demand U.S. hands off Syria, and that it's been effective in a lot of ways, but we must be clear, and especially with the unfolding situation in Iraq, we must be clear that the only way to stop this war and the only way for people anywhere to get freedom and real freedom, we must disarm the United States, and the people who can do that are the people here in the United States by creating a political movement to stop these wars and stop spending trillions on devastation and misery for millions of people. I'm honored to be here today. I'm excited to hear more personal stories, and thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Scott Williams. This sound isn't really working, I think, so we'll just let it go. Our next speaker is Jane Stillwater, and Jane is a freelance journalist, travel writer, and a blogger. She's traveled widely throughout the world, also been an embedded journalist. She works part-time as a paralegal and also as an actor, and she's the mother of four children. So, Jane Stillwater.
Thank you. And this is no act. I haven't slept in a couple of days, and I've noticed that the more tired I get, the more general my comments get. So I'll start with the specific and go to the general. How many of you here have actually been to Syria? Raise your hand. Well, then I don't have to tell you. Syria is wonderful. The people of Syria are just wonderful. And as for the election, when I was a child, I used to watch my mother running a polling place in her home and watch her stay up late and count the ballots. So I know from early experience what a fair election looks like. I also reported on recent presidential elections in Florida and Ohio, and we all know what happened there. And, of course, I myself have voted many times over the year, but I have never seen anything in the states even close to the enthusiasm and even outright joy that I witnessed while observing the elections in Syria. Do I think that they were a valid election? You bet. Okay, so then from there I went kind of like, okay, let's talk about ISIS. And this is the speech that I gave today at the UN. After being an election observer in Syria, I see ISIS from a whole new perspective. Every time I hear the phrase Islamic militant, I cringe. ISIS members are not Muslims. Let's get this clear. They are not Muslims. They are no more Muslims than Adolf Hitler was a Christian, even though he claimed to be. Muslims believe in compassion and justice. These ISIS guys are pirates. ISIS's main modus operandi in Syria was to move into a city or town, kill or drive out the civilian population, and then loot, slash, and burn. They were pirates. And the same thing happened in Mosul, where the first thing ISIS did was to loot the central bank of $500,000 while flying their...
Billion.
Good. I'm glad you guys are listening. I'm just still kind of tired. What? And you've all seen the ISIS flag. It's a black and white Jolly Roger. And ISIS doesn't want to capture Baghdad either. What it was after was the oil refinery. ISIS doesn't want to convert anyone to Islam. All they want is show me the money. And American taxpayers are paying billions of dollars to weaponize and train these crooks and robbers. And I went on to compare Bush and Cheney with Bluebeard, who gave birth to ISIS, and Obama is no Captain Jack Sparrow either. Okay, so now I'm really generalizing. I'm tired. I need to sleep. So I'm just really generalizing. Here it goes. I read somewhere that there are four things that human beings need to survive: air, water, food, and to feel good about themselves. Yet, despite me knowing this, I'm afraid that in the name of truth, I'm going to have to ignore this all and make a whole lot of people on Wall Street and War Street feel very bad about themselves. Sorry about that. Lately, everyone on the news has been talking constantly about the 70th anniversary of D-Day. D-Day this, D-Day that. But I have yet to hear anyone talking head mention the recent 100th anniversary of World War I. Probably the most unnecessary and, just plain stupid war ever fought. But sadly, America's foreign policy has just gotten dumb and dumber ever since. Next up, the badly designed Treaty of Versailles led to a very preventable World War II. And then we lost China and Korea. And just what dummy dreamed up the Cold War? Then came Vietnam, a really stupid war. A 10-year-old could have designed a better foreign policy than that. Trillions of dollars wasted and millions of lives destroyed. Then came the loss of South America's hearts and minds, the shambles that is Africa today, and the disaster after disaster in the Middle East, as our State Department just keeps riding on their express train to stupid town. But this new war on Syria has just got to be America's foreign policy's all-time low, unless, of course, you count their support of the neo-Nazis in Ukraine. America has actually hired Al-Qaeda, of all people, to spearhead an invasion of Syria, a place where America shouldn't even have a dog in the fight, let alone an Al-Qaeda dog. And America's military-industrial complex actually supports ISIS and Daesh? A 5-year-old could have designed a better foreign policy than that, solely based on what his kindergarten teacher taught him. And as an American, I just want this stupidity to stop.
Thank you, Jane. Okay, we're next going to hear from Judy Bello, who is a part of the Administrative Committee of the United National Anti-War Coalition, and she's a founder of the Upstate Coalition to Ground the Drones and End the War. She's traveled in the past extensively to other hot spots, including to Iran with the Fellowship of Reconciliation, to Iraq, Pakistan, and was part of this delegation. So, Judy Bello.
Hi. I'm really pleased to be here with you today. And since I went to Syria as an observer, and maybe some of you haven't been there that recently, or you'd just like to hear stories about being in Syria and some of the people I met when I was observing the election, and I thought that would be a nice something you might be interested in hearing about. So I went to Tartus. I did not choose to go to one of the hot spots in at the moment in Syria, and I guess I just wanted to know more about the country. And when I went there, from the very beginning, I had it in my mind that as a woman, I wanted to reach out to Syrian women, because here in America, we don't know much about, you know, the lives of Arab women and Syrian women in particular, and just to hear some of their feedback on the election and on life in the war and life in Syria. So to go to Tartus, I had to fly, and so we went to this Damascus International Airport. When we left, all I saw was this one little plane that we were flying on in this beautiful building that they have empty. except for a couple of the people with me and these three or no four lovely Pakistani people who flew out with us, and some North Koreans. So I got on the plane, one woman amongst about 40 people, and we flew to Latakia. And when we flew in, there was a snake line of people there waiting for us in the airport to greet us. And so we had a whole large group of greeters receiving line. We went down the receiving line, and I immediately knew that I was right about wanting to meet the Syrian women, because there were these three women in the middle of this long line, mostly men. And when I reached them in the receiving line, one by one, they each gave me a huge hug and kissed me three times on the cheek and said, "Welcome to Syria." So this was really very heartening to me. And it turns out that the three of them are all MPs and members of the parliament in Syria. And two of them were from Tartus and one from Latakia. And so I traveled the rest of my journey with, among other people, the two women from Tartus. So we got in our cars, and I traveled at first in a car with a group of men, again MPs. My translator was late, and we picked her up a couple stops down the road. And because apparently they called her in the morning and said, "Show up, we need an English translator right now." And so it took her a little bit to meet us. But in the car, there was a man named Nisar who was translating, and he introduced each of the men in the car, and this man's a businessman, and this man's a doctor, and finally, and I'm an attorney, and finally a man got in the car, and he said, "This is a dentist, so if you need help with your teeth, he'd be happy to help you." And I said, "Well, it sounds like any service I need is provided by someone in this car, so I think I'm in good hands." And Nisar was, said that he was born in Banyas, which was our first stop. And before we got there, though, he told me a story. He showed me a place where there had been a bridge where 40 young Syrian soldiers were killed when the insurgents blew the bridge out from under them. And I realized, you know, as we came into Banyas, there were images everywhere of the young people from that community who had died in this war, because Syria, as many of you know, has a draft. And so the people who are fighting to save their country are, many of them are 18 to 20-year-olds who are serving their regular military duty. And it's very heartbreaking, even for the communities where the war isn't like pressed right up against them, to have their youth at this level of risk. Because most of the people, the largest, single largest group of people killed in this war, are Syrian soldiers. As we drove into Tartus, I'd just like to say, I remembered the day before that the Speaker of the Parliament had told us that Syria is food self-sufficient. And there were miles and miles of little greenhouses with plastic covers packed with tomatoes and corn and other vegetables among the olive groves. So I better move along with my story, though. I just wanted to tell you my translator story, and then I'll be done. She said to me, after we'd been traveling quite a while together, and we were sharing single mother stories, because I'm a single mother and she was a widow. And she said, I asked her about the election, and she said, "Actually, I used to be a rebel." She said, "My husband and my brother both died quite a while ago. And my brother in particular died in a Syrian prison, and we were never able to get his body back. And it was heartbreaking for our family." And I said, "Wow, and now you're translating for this trip. And are you going to vote for Bashar Assad?" And she said, "Yes, actually I am, because, you know, I came here from Hama, and I was able to go to school for free. And I became an English teacher, and now I am the supervisor for all of the English teachers in Tartus." And she said, "I've never been so happy in my life, because I'm a respected member of the community. And I I still feel heartbroken when I think about what happened to my brother. But right now, I have a good life. My children are in college, and they have prospects for a good life. And I really want to see security and civilization restored, because those are working for me and my family. And I thought that was an incredibly moving story, and that this woman who'd essentially been abandoned by the men in her family because they died in the process, or you know, in the process of rebelling against the government, now finds herself happy being a citizen of the country and at peace with what's going on there. So I really had wanted to tell you this story, and I have many others, so maybe you'll read my blog and hear them in the future. Deconstructedglobe.com. And I'm very happy again to meet all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. We're next going to hear from Joe Iosbacher, who is an activist with the Anti-War Committee in Chicago. And nationally, Joe is on the Administrative Committee of the United National Anti-War Coalition. He was one of the coordinators of a very important national coalition march of 15,000 people against NATO when NATO, you could say, invaded Chicago to hold a big international gathering, and in doing so shut down the whole city of Chicago in an effort to shut down quite an important demonstration. And of course, he's also been very active in the movement to oppose U.S. intervention in Syria. So, Joe Iosbacher.
Thank you, and again, it's an honor to be here this evening with all of you, Mr. Ambassador, and friends from Chicago who have now transplanted to New York. I wanted to tell you, first of all, that I also wrote about one article a day while I was in Syria, and there are copies back there on the table. I published them in fightbacknews.org. You can find them. I want to begin, though, by telling an experience that I have that I think the people of Syria do not have. So we have been told in the United States these last 3 years that Syria is a one-party state. You've all heard this expression, one-party state. Well, I actually happen to live in a one-party state. It's called Chicago. In the city of Chicago, no, it's true. There has not been, every mayor has been from the same party, the Democratic Party, Barack Obama's party, since 1931. Almost 90 years, same party in power. In Chicago, there are 50 members of the city council. Guess how many there are that are Republicans? None. Guess when the last time there was any Republicans in the city council in Chicago? 1948. There are 25 members of the state council from Chicago, all Democrats. There are 6 members of the federal Congress, they call them, all Democrats. There has not been a Republican elected in Chicago in anyone's lifetime. And so what you see from that, it is a joke, of course, to call it a one-party state. What it is the people of Chicago, they're Democrats. And what I saw in Syria is that the vast majority of the people came out to vote for the man that they felt represented their interests. And what were their interests? First and foremost, was to end this war, and second, to restore the Syria that existed until 3 years ago, a prosperous, a secular country where everyone belonged. So I came away from Syria with this hope, that this election would mark the beginning of the end of this war. You know, we heard from Ba'ath Party activists, we heard from Jihad al-Laham, the Speaker of the Parliament, and from regular people at the polling places, that the right-wing rebels really are already beaten. They have no vision. To keep them fighting. You know, clearly, 73% of the population came out and voted. The rebels are isolated, and even the Pentagon recognizes that they're losing militarily. So the only question in my mind is, will the United States allow this war to come to an end? And, you know, or will they continue to fund it? And will they look for more pretexts, like the lies about the chemical gas last summer? And, you know, because I cannot say yes, in fact, I'm almost certain that the answer is no, this leads to the role that we all have going back home. There's a very low level of understanding. I'm telling you, you already know this because you live here. There's a very low level of understanding of Syria among the American people. So we have a job to do, and it's helpful to understand something though in understanding the job we have to do, which is, while it's uphill in teaching the American people. The American people, and we told this to the Syrians at every rally, at every polling place, they don't want this war. They are tired of war. We have not lost as many sons and daughters as you have lost. We have lost, you know, 7,000 dead in the last 11 years, and we've spent our national wealth as well. So. I also want to, I'm actually going to abuse my privilege and stay on the mic for one more minute. I also want to tell you that I know that we can have an impact on the U.S. plans for war, because we did it last summer. We helped to stop the plans to bomb Syria. And I also know that we are considered a threat by the U.S. government, because my home was raided by the FBI several years ago for my anti-war activity. And I have to tell you that while we are building this anti-war movement, we also have to defend our people. We have to defend the anti-war protesters, and we have to defend, especially in the United States, the Arab and Muslim, and especially the Palestinian population, because they are under attack by the U.S. government. And I'm going to tell you about one case in particular from Chicago, my dear sister, Rasmia Oda. She is being put on trial in the United States because they claim that she was convicted by an Israeli military court in 1969 for being a terrorist. They tortured her into confession, and now they're going to put her on trial. She's been a citizen for 20 years, living a model life. They want to put her in prison at age 66 and then deport her for something that she never did. She was tortured, brutally tortured, into confessing to this crime that the Israelis accuse her of. She's going on trial on September 8th in Detroit. I'm going to be there, and I would invite everyone to join me in Detroit on September 8th. Thank you, everyone.
And I do hope everyone here will actually go online and sign the petition for Rasmia Oda, along with paying great attention to the September 8th court date. Okay, last of the five delegates, we're going to hear from Dr. Paul Larudee. He is a faculty member of several universities in the San Francisco Bay Area. He is an organizer with the Palestine Solidarity Movement and the International Solidarity Movement in Palestine, and was a co-founder of the movement to break the Israeli siege of Gaza by sea. He was aboard the boats that succeeded in doing so in 2008 and participated in the Gaza Freedom Flotilla. He was a co-founder of the Global March to Jerusalem. So next up, Dr. Paul Larudee.
One of my other credentials is that I'm a piano tuner. So I have a special interest in promoting harmony. So. um, some of you will remember, maybe better than me, that the former Consul General of Israel to New York, I think only a year ago, was visiting here, and he was asked by one of the Zionist publications what he thought would be the best outcome in Syria as far as Israel is concerned. What's Israel's interest? And his name, I think, was Pinchon or Pinchas, one of these. Anyway, he said the best outcome as far as Israel is concerned is no outcome. No outcome. Now, that is honesty, because Israel, and this is quite reflective of the United States, and that's not an accident that Israel and the United States coincide in their view, it's eternal conflict and death and destruction. This is the future for Syria and Iraq and Libya and all of these. Let's be honest about it. This is what the purpose is. In order to create weakness among groups that are considered allies, and to show nations of the world that if they do not do exactly what the United States and NATO says, there will be hell to pay. This is what it's about. What is Syria's sin? Syria has no foreign debt. It doesn't permit other companies to come in there and own half of the country and to export its wealth. And this is the problem with Syria. This is why Syria has to be destroyed. And yet the American people don't feel this way. The American people are ashamed of causing death and destruction, if they even understand that it is our government that is causing this. This is terrible. So I want to thank the Syrian people for showing us in this election, which we went to as observers, and we have to come out with an observation. And our observation is that the Syrian people who traveled from across the world. We met Syrian people. When we were in Syria, we met people from the United States and from many other countries who traveled there in order to vote. Who does this? And they voted in massive numbers in foreign countries when they could, when they were not prevented from doing it. Who is going to do this? And yet the outcome was certain. We knew what the outcome was going to be. We knew who was going to. Why do they do this? Well, I'll tell you why. Because they were sending a message. And what is an election if it is not sending a message to the entire world and to their leadership about who they want? And they did. They did in massive numbers. Compare that, for example, with the election in Egypt, where 92% of the people voted for el-Sisi. Well, 92% of what people? You know, how many people showed up? And there were at least twice as many who showed up in the Syrian election as in the Egyptian election. That is the difference. That is the difference. Because what the Syrian people wanted was very clear. And that is the purpose of an election, and that's what we saw. Joe and I were together in Homs, and we saw the same things that everyone else has reported. Just jubilant celebration. It was a way. People said as much outside the polling booth as they did inside the polling booth, and it was magnificent. So, And who are the Syrian people? There were. What about the occupied areas of Syria where no one could vote? Well, those people voted with their feet. They left those occupied areas. They 6 million of them are living in government-controlled areas of Syria because they prefer that to living under the regime of terrorists, basically. So they voted, And they voted a second time by casting their ballot in those government areas. And furthermore, they voted not to become refugees over outside Syria because twice as many of them are displaced persons within Syria as they are outside Syria. Twice as many preferred to live in Syria under government control rather than to go to Lebanon or to Turkey or anywhere else. That's impressive. So one little story I'll tell you about Homs is that I happened to go back after the election, and I happened to be in a meeting where municipal leaders and leaders of the Christian community were discussing the reconstruction of the old city of Homs, and they had everything down to the last stone and the last owner of every single place and how it was going to be constructed and who was going to do the work and which foundations were going to provide the funding. This is less than a month after it was liberated. So what I saw there was a people that were determined to have for their will to be imposed upon the future of Syria, not only in the terms of their president, but in rebuilding wherever it was possible to rebuild in the retaken areas. I don't think these people are going to lose this war. I don't think so. They're absolutely determined.
I want to thank every one of you. When you speak now, I felt our kids telling me thanks a lot. Thanks a lot to everyone fighting to bring the peace in my country and let our kids have the peace and happy. Every word you say, my soul fly and hug each kid in Syria and tell them we here. We try to bring the happiness and the peace to you. Thanks a lot from my heart and our kids' heart and our Syrian people. Thanks a lot.
It's so interesting hearing five people speak. They all traveled to Syria, and not one of them repeated one point that another speaker made. They looked at it each with different eyes and from different experiences, and that makes for quite an interesting, and it's also true in the articles. There's a listing in the back. A number of those articles were reprinted, so I really encourage you, and on their blogs, it's all over the internet, to read these, because there are a lot of experiences and personal vignettes and stories of who they met that really helped to explain in many ways Syria. Before I introduce our next speaker here, I want to say that after Ramsey Clark speaks, we'll have a little time for some questions or comments from the floor. We won't go too long. We have a couple of other things to do, but it is an honor for me to introduce Ramsey Clark, who is a founder of the International Action Center. As you all know, he's a former U.S. Attorney General, an international human rights lawyer. I traveled to Syria with Ramsey in September and to Iraq many times over the years of U.S. sanctions. Of course, he also has traveled to Iran during the most difficult times, and for Palestine endlessly, along with, we could list so many other countries and struggles, but works for political prisoners here, death row prisoners, those in solitary and in isolation right here in the United States. And we can never forget that the largest prison population in the world is right here. The largest number of people on death row, the largest number of people in solitary confinement. So Ramsey Clark has also been a voice for them. So please join me in welcoming Ramsey Clark.
Syria has been beautiful and important to the human condition for as long as history. And we dare not let it be destroyed. I don't know which one of these sound. Does that sound?
Yeah, but it doesn't. Well, we'll see. If there's a hum, we'll turn it off.
I'll speak louder if I can. That's true. Can y'all hear me in the back now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I'll give you a Texas shout if you're not careful. So hold your ears. The great mosque in Damascus has in the center of it the tomb of John the Baptist. And they're always, I've never been in there, there weren't people praying in there. But around that tomb, there are as many Muslims as there are Christians. In fact, there are more Muslims than there are Christians. And there are three minarets for this mosque. It's a huge and gorgeous piece of architecture and history, and one of the three is named for Jesus, which I've always thought reveals the possibility of peace on earth. We owe a lot to Syria, and we owe a lot to the courage of the people in this terrible experience that they've been going through, that God willing is approaching an end. I think circumstances may, or chance, may get the U.S. military off their backs. Our country holds the primary responsibility. It's a hard thing for an American to have to say, particularly if you'd like to be able to love your country and still love truth and justice. But our duty as citizens here is to end our militarism. All my life, it's just been militarism. Korea and Vietnam, and Vietnam is amazing. Last year was the 40th anniversary of the end of the Vietnamese War, and it was a hellacious war. I mean, we did everything we could to destroy that country, and the people are thriving. The people are happy. It may be five members of the family on one motorcycle, but they're happy. They got plenty of food. The schools are good. There's really only one remembrance of the war that they can't escape, and that's the deformed infants that are still being born from Agent Orange. Nothing like the numbers that occurred earlier, but still, it's hard to go in a hospital with maternity ward and not see a handful of cruelly deformed infants, which is one of the most horrible things that war brings. Syria is critically important to peace on earth, and our country's been the principal power exercising violence, constantly refining technology for death. And we have to find the will to stand up and resist and reverse that. And we need to do it while Syria can still help us see the beauty and dignity of humanity, and what many believe is the oldest city in the world, the oldest continuously populated place in the world, the capital of Syria, can be a center for not just the survival, but finally the realization of the full potential of the human species. The survival of Syria is essential to the survival of humanity, I believe.